Thank you. The Lord Almighty, holy is the Lord. Good morning to all of you. Welcome to this wonderful opportunity, the service that we have the privilege of being able to participate in, to be part of, and to be able to host. My name is Joel Kaiser. I'm one of the pastors at St. Lawrence. Assisting today will be Adam Tanney, who is our vicar for this year, our pastor intern, and we're privileged to have him with us as well. And it has been a privilege for St. Lawrence to host this service for quite a number of years now. So I'd like to send a special word of welcome to those of you who may be joining us for the very first time here in the Kern Pavilion. Or if you've been coming every year, regardless, we have this wonderful opportunity to gather as the people of God, to pray for our country, to give thanks to the Lord for the freedoms and the blessings that he has given to us in this land. A number of announcements before we begin. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to all those who have indeed worked so hard and put in so much time and effort behind the scenes and otherwise. We think of Tom Ryan and Jim Bender, our co-chairs for this, and all of the volunteers who assisted with setup and takedown and everything else that goes in between. I also would like to thank our musicians here today, our conductors, Miles Hayden, Michael Keller, and Bobby Cody, and all of those who have joined to share their gifts of music with us. And like to thank our American Legion and those who are participating in that official capacity this morning as well. So if you would join me in giving a round of applause to all of those who are although it did not make the print copy of our worship folder, there will be a offering that will be gathered immediately following the message. So as good Lutherans, we never miss an opportunity for passing the plate. So how it didn't make the print, I'm not sure. But having said that, just be mindful that immediately following the message, our ushers will be collecting an offering at that point. Following the service, we are in need of some volunteers, and that is to help tear down specifically with stacking of the chairs that are here. Some of you have done that in the past. You probably are familiar with the particular way in which they need to be stacked. There is some little bit of training that needs to happen before those chairs get stacked. If you are able to assist with that following the service, you're simply asked to make your way to the southwest corner and gather there for that little bit of instruction. Very important to make sure that as those chairs go on the pallets and so forth, that they're done exactly right. So we appreciate whatever assistance you may be able to give with that part of the teardown. Following our service, of course, as people are leaving, and as crowds are dispersing, just be mindful, of course, that with the number of vehicles and so forth, that there will be some delay. And so just ask for your patience ahead of time. And so be able to enjoy the post-service music, or if you need to immediately go to your vehicle, fine. But just, again, be mindful of the need for some patience. We, again, have such a wonderful blessing in this land that God has given to us, and it is with deepest humility and thanksgiving that we now participate in this service. At this time, I would invite all of you, as you are able to please stand as the color guard will post our colors.
Thank you. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. O come, let us worship the Lord. Let us offer him our praise and thanksgiving. Pray. Lord, please keep our nation under your divine care. Bless the leaders of our land that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to the other nations of the earth. Help us to elect trustworthy officials, contribute to wise decisions for the general welfare of all, and serve you faithfully in our generation to the glory of your holy name and the blessing of all your people. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
The Old Testament reading for this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 28. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to Hananiah, the prophet, in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord make the words that you have prophesied come true and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. Yet hear now this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes to pass, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. This is the word of the Lord." The epistle reading comes from Romans chapter 8. "There is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." This is the word of the Lord.
Is true, is high.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, beginning in the 8th chapter. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Marching on. The word of the Lord from John chapter 8. Jesus said to the Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. The year was 1865. The Civil War had been going for 4 years. But now, it was over. But still, there was work to be done. General Gordon Granger, and approximately 2,000 Union troops had one mission to carry out. They marched and made their way to Texas, Galveston Bay, Texas, not for battle, but for a proclamation. You see, truth needed to be shared in one last place so that there would be freedom. On June the 19th, 1865, in Galveston Bay, Texas, on Texas soil, General Gordon Granger carried out, as he stood on Texas soil and read General Order Number 3. The people of Texas are informed that in accordance with a proclamation from the Executive of the United States, all slaves are free. That proclamation had been made and signed by President Lincoln some 2.5 years previous. The war had ended some 2 months prior, and yet the truth had not been proclaimed, at least not to everyone. June 19th has come then to symbolize the final announcement of that era of the freedom that was proclaimed and won for those who were enslaved. Celebrations certainly took place. Texas's some 250,000 slaves were free. Each year, there were celebrations. In 1979, the governor of Texas made Juneteenth a state holiday. And in 2021, it was made a federal holiday. The truth had been proclaimed, and there was freedom. You see, the truth must be proclaimed in order for those to know and to believe the truth, in order to be free. And that is what took place. But it's not that easy. There were those that did not want that message, that truth, to be shared. And so great lengths had to be taken so that message would be heard and understood and believed. You see, the application of what took place in the Civil War and following is just another way in which we as Christians can see how our circumstances in a spiritual level play out. Christ has set us free. But if a slave doesn't believe or know the truth, a slave is not free. I'm here to proclaim to you that you have been set free. Paul in the book of Romans lays it out like this. He says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free from the law of sin and death. So why is it that so often we choose not to live as freed people. Perhaps you're familiar with Admiral Jim Stockdale. During the Vietnam War, he was the highest-ranking U.S. military officer in what was called the Hanoi Hilton, a prisoner of war camp. And during his 8 years, he was tortured repeatedly. He experienced all the deprivations and the horrors of what being a prisoner of war meant in that place. And yet, he survived. He went on to thrive in his life, in his ability to communicate, and in many different ventures, not the least of which was serving as a professor. When asked about how he did it, how he survived, what he said has become known as the Stockdale Principle, or I should say the Stockdale Paradox. A paradox, two statements that are both true but seem to be in conflict with each other. The Stockdale Principle is basically like this. One must have an unwavering faith in the final outcome that one will prevail, but at the very same time have the discipline to be able to confront the brutal facts of one's reality. You must believe that there will be overcoming and freedom in the end, but in the meantime, to face the brutal facts. Truth must face the brutal facts. When asked who didn't survive, who didn't make it out of the Hanoi Hilton, he responded, those who would say things like, we're going to be out by Christmas. By Christmas, we will be set free, we'll be liberated. But when Christmas came and went without freedom, then it was pushed to Easter. But then as Easter came and went, then it was Thanksgiving, and so on, year after year of building up one's hopes without facing the brutal facts that that was not going to be the case. He said those that believed their own reality, they are the ones who died of a broken spirit and heart. You see, if one creates their own truth, that person is not free. That reading from Jeremiah takes quite a bit of backstory, but in short, Jeremiah speaks to this prophet named Hananiah, who had just proclaimed to the people gathered in the temple in Jerusalem, after some of their citizens had been carried away in exile, they were prisoners in Babylon. And in that situation, Hananiah, this prophet, so to speak, said, the Lord will deliver us, and in 2 years, the vessels of this temple will be returned, and all of the exiles with them. Jeremiah responds, amen. Let it be. I pray that it is. But then he went on to proclaim that those who proclaim peace and an end to war and prisoners and slavery are only sent from God if and when their prophecies come true. 2 years came and went, and Hananiah's words were not fulfilled. It would be 70 years before the exiles would be returned. You see, not dealing with the brutal facts is not freedom. That's also what Jesus ran into in our reading from the Gospel of John, where he says to the Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, then you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." But in their reality, they said, "What are you talking about? Why do we need to hear about freedom? Because we are not slaves." Oh, how wrong they were. And how wrong you and I would be to claim that same truth today. Yes, we live in a land of freedom. We have the ability to come and go as we please and to worship the Lord and to exercise our business and pleasure. But yet Jesus says, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. Did you realize that? That every time you disobey the Lord, whether it's failing to keep his law, whether it's failing to fulfill the law of love to help and serve our neighbor and the Lord, or whether it's a blatant disregard for our neighbor's well-being, or intentional hurt, or pride, or selfishness. Every time we practice sin, it is a reminder to us that we indeed are not free. And those are the brutal facts. You are a sinner. And therefore, you are a slave. We don't like to talk that way. We like to ignore that. We like to create our own reality, our own truth. The good news of smile, God loves you, without the word of the law. And yet it's by God's grace that we can have unwavering faith and yet still face the brutal facts. Dear Heavenly Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, is what we can say. But we do so with the unwavering faith in the final outcome. And that brings us to our third and final point, that the truth calls for sacrifice. There was a man by the name of Telemachus. It's kind of an odd name. Maybe that's because he lived some 1,600 years ago. And his story is recorded in history, but some of the details are not clear. Historians will argue and debate. But yet his story is powerful enough and indeed true enough that it has been shared over the centuries. In fact, just a week ago, through our Lutheran Hour ministry sermon, his story was referenced. Chuck Colson has referenced it, and even President Ronald Reagan, on two separate occasions at the National Prayer Breakfast back in 1984 and 85, took the opportunity to tell Telemachus's story. He was a monk. He lived in Asia Minor, Turkey, today. He lived in a monastery, an ascetic life of deprivation and piety. And yet it is said that he felt moved by the Spirit of the Lord to go to Rome, the capital of the Roman Empire. And while he was there, he felt moved to go to the Colosseum, in which there were gladiator fights happening. And he felt moved not only to go in and witness this fight till the death, but he was so moved by the Spirit that he indeed climbed over the wall down into the arena with the gladiators. And in an attempt to stop this bloodshed and this unholy treatment of fellow human beings, he cried out, "Stop in the name of Christ." Three times at least, we're told, he cried that. Now, whether it was one of the gladiator contestants who thrust his sword through him, or whether it was the angry crowd who was having their entertainment interrupted, who hurled rocks at him, the bottom line is Telemachus gave his life that day on the arena floor. And when word of this came to the Emperor Honorius, he was so moved that he proclaimed Telemachus one of the great victors of the gladiator games, and from that day forward declared that there would no longer be such games. You see, Telemachus knew the truth, and he was willing to die for it. He was indeed free. And isn't that the case? That someone who is willing to die for the truth is indeed free. I'm sure you've connected the dots. How else could one hear these accounts and these stories without recognizing the sacrificial death of our Lord and Savior, Jesus? Jesus knew the truth. In fact, he was the truth. He came to proclaim that truth, but he came to sacrifice for that truth. He came to give his life so that others would not be enslaved and be doomed. It is through his life, death, and resurrection that not only has freedom been proclaimed to you, but that freedom has been won, has been fought for, blood has been shed, so that you can now live a life of freedom. What an incredible blessing that we have, that not only do we live in a free country, but wherever we live, wherever we go, and throughout time, God's people live in true freedom. A freedom that must be proclaimed. A truth that must confront the brutal facts. And a truth that calls for sacrifice. So if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God, which may guard your hearts and minds and keep you in the true faith to life everlasting. Amen. When we have said the pledges of allegiance, which will happen shortly, following that time, we once again, as has been the custom and tradition here, will be inviting to the front all of those in attendance who are able to join up front, who are either veterans or current military personnel, or who have or are serving in the public safety arena, including police, fire, emergency workers, and so forth. So please be mindful that at that point in time, following our pledges, that those will be invited to come forward. We worship the Lord with our offerings.
We stand as we pledge our allegiance to the American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Pledge our allegiance to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ and to the faith for which it stands, one Savior eternal, with mercy and grace for all. At this time, we invite for the tribute all current and former military and safety personnel to the front. Let us pray. Gracious God and Father, guide this nation by your Spirit to go forward in justice and freedom. Give to all our people the blessings of well-being and harmony, but above all things, give us faith in you, that our nation may bring glory to your name and blessings to all people. Almighty God, watch over all who make, judge, and administer the laws of our nation, and preserve us from sinful contempt of good order and godly laws. Give to our authorities integrity and honor, and bless all inhabitants with charity and love. Protect and defend this nation, O Lord, from every threat without and within. Keep those who serve in our armed forces under your gracious care, as well as those who serve our communities as police, fire, and public safety personnel. Hear us on their behalf as we name those now who are a part of our St. Lawrence congregation and family. Horatio Babcock, Levi Belil, Caleb Bickle, Ryan Butler, Aiden Clark, Christopher Konzelman, Fernando Davis, David DeFord, Angela Dremmer, Connor Duff, Zion Eichelberger, Tyler Evans, Andrew Fedulum, Evan Glowiak, David Green, Derek Hart, Leland Hart, Carrie Hauk, Dallas Jackson, Tyler Johnson, Joshua Keppendorfer, Corey Knoll, Jeffrey Knoll, Matthew Kuhl, Alexander Leach, Nathan Moulton, Sean O'Connor, Jacob Palmreiter, Max Robertson, Antonio Santiago IV, Joseph Schaefer, Micah Schieffer, Sean Shruby, Tanya Siebold, Chelsea Tansley, Rob Tansley, Chad Vance, Tyler Walker, Michaela Walensky, Eric T. Zender, and Jacob Zender. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have set us free from slavery to sin that is part of our daily existence. May we believe the truth of our freedom, proclaim this truth, and be ever willing to sacrifice for it as we live our lives of freedom and joy in Christ. O most merciful God, Lord of heaven and earth, rule and govern your church and all her pastors, teachers, and church workers, that she may be preserved in the pure doctrine of your saving word and defended against all adversaries, that thereby faith may be strengthened and love increased in us. Bless those who serve your church and keep them in humble faith, that they may continue to bear witness to your grace. Especially do we pray for Aaron Washer, Jeffrey Weiss, Courtney Werner, and Katie Winningham. Raise up more women and men to serve your harvest fields. We thank and praise you for the gift of spiritual life and faith that you have created in the hearts of Cooper Weiss, Graham Zells, and Briggs Zells through the sacrament of holy baptism. Bless them as they grow in faith and knowledge along with their parents and families. Continue to pour out your favor upon Laverne Diamond and Marlis Schieffer as they celebrate their 50th wedding anniversary this Friday. Sustain them in faith as they grow closer to you and to each other through every joy and sorrow shared. Place your hand of healing and mercy upon all in need, especially Reverend Rodney Reinerson, Gary Konzelman, Dean Bickle, and Jennifer Shetler. Restore them to health according to your will. Sustain them in their faith and give them peace in heart and mind. And give an extra measure of your spirit of comfort to the family and friends of Dwayne Dewey Fisher as they mourn his death. May they know the assurance of your love and the certainty of your promises. And Lord, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
following our closing hymn, would again ask that if you are able to assist, to volunteer with helping to take down chairs and stack them, that you would meet in the southwest corner of the auditorium immediately following. We again would like to take this opportunity to thank you for being here and joining us in this wonderful worship, and we ask that we would again show our appreciation not just to our veterans and public safety personnel, but again to all of our volunteers and all who have been part of this wonderful service. And now please stand as you receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Storm clouds gather far across the sea. Let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair.